So I can't see it on the screen here, but we're going to move on. So again, I'm just going to explain a little bit about who we are, who we're not, because again, people don't always understand. I know everyone in the room here is not from the Delaware Basin, but that's okay. Hang in there. We'll talk about one case study, and then we'll talk about how we collaborate on a regulatory basis, mostly with the DEP, and I think that's got a lot of advantages to you as the regulated community. So who we are? Well, we're not these folks. I know, you know, my neighbors come to me sometime and they say, Steve, are you really going to raise the tolls on Patco again for that train that crosses the Del River? And I'm like, no, that's not me. You know, people really, if it has the word Del River in it, doesn't mean it's a DRBC. We are focused on water resource management. We don't do the ferries. We don't do the bridges. We're focused on water resource management. We're not EPA, we're not DEP, we certainly proud of our environmental record, but we're a water resource management agency. These are the Delaware River Basin commissioners, and one of them may seem familiar to Commissioner McCabe, and that's Governor Murphy. He's the current chair of the DRBC right now. The commissioners are the four governors, and it's also a representative of the federal government, in this case, Major General Jeffrey Milhorn, who's the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers representative. There's five equal members to the Delaware River Basin Commission. Again, the four governors serve the four states of Delaware, New Jersey, Pennsylvania, and New York, along with the federal government. The commissioners may select alternates. In fact, the people I typically deal with are the alternates. Commissioner McCabe is the first alternate for Governor Murphy, and there are other alternates as well that I typically deal with at the DEP, DEC, Pennsylvania DEP level. The federal commissioner is the Army Corps of Engineers, but the federal representative actually represents all the federal agencies. So when you say, well, why don't you interact with the EPA? Well, I do interact with the EPA all the time, but EPA actually works through the Army Corps of Engineers when it comes to policy and issues and regulation related to the federal government. Majority rules, we meet quarterly, but from a staff perspective, we're a relatively small staff. We've got a broad authority. There's about 39 professional planners, engineers, and scientists. At least three of us are here today, so that's over 5%, 6%, something like that. So our budget is relatively small. We get about 27% of our budget from what we call our signatory members, and we're located in West Trenton, New Jersey. A little bit on the Delaware River and why it's so special and why it matters a lot to how we manage is the fact that the Delaware River is an interstate river from end to end, from its headwaters in Hancock, New York, all the way down to the Atlantic Ocean. When you're standing on one shore, looking across the river, you're always looking at another state. And when you think of water resource management, think of what you do. If there's something in one state and another state is not addressing it, how are you going to make improvements from a water resource perspective? The Delaware River, again, from a service standpoint, serves about 13 million people, about 5% of the U.S. population. And not only does the water stay in the basin, but a lot of water leaves the basin as well. For example, New York City gets about half its drinking water from the Delaware River Basin. That effectively leaves the basin. And New Jersey gets water through the DNR Canal from the Delaware River as well. It serves Central and North Jersey as well. About 4.6 billion gallons a day are withdrawn every day from the basin. Now, if you're in the Delaware River, it's an amazing place. From end to end, it is a gem, and I love it. You can see, you know, just from some of these pictures, some of the amazing sites in the Delaware Basin. You're looking at some of the upstream or upper basin pictures up there, but the down basin as well. In the middle there is Camden, New Jersey. Amazing, amazing waterfront development that's happened over the past several years. And why do people want to come back to the water? When I moved to this area 35 years ago or so, people said, you know, hey, don't drink the water from Philly, and, you know, don't go down there, it stinks. But now it's completely turned around because people want to be back by the water again. It didn't always look like that. In the 20s, we all know this story, right? Pre-Clean Water Act, do what you want, dump what you want. Raw sewage, industrial waste, very common. So from a clean water perspective, this was not uncommon in the Delaware River and its tributaries. But also, it also has challenges as well, not just from a clean water perspective, but from a water supply perspective. Two extremes there. You see the extreme flooding in eastern Phillipsburg from the flood in 1955. In the 1960s, the major drought that occurred in the Delaware River Basin, that's Trenton, New Jersey, in the 1960s. So sometimes it looked like this as well. And that I'm an engineer, I think the basin looks like this. Because from my perspective, again, I love the pretty pictures, and I love, you know, I've been on the Delaware Sojourn, I've been canoeing and kayaking and all that stuff. But what people don't always appreciate is that while it is beautiful, it is natural, it is also engineered, it is planned, it is managed as much as we can. Let's face it, ultimately, there's only a limit to what we can manage. But from my perspective, we manage the river as well. So the problems that occurred in the river, and the reason why the Delaware Basin Commission was formed in the first place, is at some point, there was fights over water. And you can see that always with an interstate perspective. New York City wants to take water, whoa. New Jersey and Pennsylvania saying, what? Oh, that's my water, you can't take that water. So that ended up in the Supreme Court a couple of times. That could be a whole presentation. I won't go there, but there were fights over water. There was severe pollution in the Delaware River, serious flooding. Something had to be done. The challenge, not all these agents, not all these political entities deal with water resources, but just the fact that it's four states, you had New York City, multiple other political entities that potentially could get involved with water, there needed to be a better solution. Water doesn't know political boundaries. Water knows watersheds. You all know that. And someone had to look at this from a broader perspective, and that's why the commission was formed. In 1961, President Kennedy and the four basin states, think about it, 1961, this is early in Kennedy's administration. The four basin states had big problems. They were urging him to do something. And they collectively decided to get together and do something and create a vision, create a plan for the water resource of the basin collectively because of those big problems. The compact itself was signed, its legislation in the four basin states and its legislation at the federal level. It's also an agreement as to how they would manage the resource collectively. Our compact is probably different than other compacts that are out there, and that's okay. Effectively, they threw the kitchen sink at us. Now again, we do certain things more than others, but the basic, the big issues are that create a plan for the region and manage it through regulation. And you can see some of the other issues, and we'll touch on these as well. But our core responsibilities, and if I'm not, you know, if I'm speaking, I'm not talking about these core responsibilities, I'm not doing my job, are one, is there an adequate and sustainable supply of water for this region into the future? And two, is it clean and healthy? Do we have a clean and healthy water system for all sorts of uses in the river? We all know this, right? I mean, this is part of what you do. Quality of basin waters, quality of any water shall be maintained, and this is a part of in our compact. You see it in regulation, said different ways, but it shall be maintained for public drinking water after reasonable treatment, recreation, wildlife, fish, and other aquatic life, and regulated waste assimilation. So that's basically designated uses, right? Now, recently, in Philadelphia, I know you're off in Philadelphia, WHYY put together a news story there, the public news agency in Philadelphia, with this headline, and the headline's relatively accurate, how the Clean Water Act fixed the Delaware River pollution problem. To some degree, well, that is true, but it's not that simple. I mean, basically what the article said was this: Delaware River stunk, it was polluted, Clean Water Act came in 1972, gave Philadelphia a whole bunch of water, Philadelphia built a bunch of sewage treatment, river got clean. To some degree that's true, but that's not the whole story. This is an interstate water. How do we manage from an interstate water perspective? What if Philadelphia was the only one to clean up their side of the river? How did this really happen from a regional perspective? So I want to get into this this issue a little bit on the case today. And you all know the Clean Water Act, and again, Pete's here, and you know, he knows this better than I do, and Commissioner McCabe. But let me touch on how we fit into this. Because when you look at the Clean Water Act responsibilities for EPA, by the way, Tom's relatively new at DRBC, but if I'm going over, he has the permission to kick me. So you see the states there, the state responsibilities, and the tribes there as well. But we'll flow down the state flow chart there. And I know that there's more to the Clean Water Act than this. But I'm going to touch on where DRBC comes into the Clean Water Act responsibilities for an interstate water. When I talk about the interstate water, I'm talking about the main stem Delaware River. We certainly have responsibilities for the basin, but we're talking about the main stem Delaware River. So you've got water quality standards, which I think you all understand, designated uses, water quality criteria, anti-degradation standards. For the main stem Delaware River, and this is where the DRBC comes in, because a lot of times people say, well, the Clean Water Act doesn't say anything about river basin commissions. Where do you guys come in? Well, effectively, we come in on interstate water because the states work with us. And we work with them on how to do several things for the main stem Delaware River collectively, collaboratively, together. so that we're setting standards for the Del River as a common body. So from a mainstem Del River perspective, DRBC establishes or revises water quality standards, water quality criteria, and designated uses. State regulations will typically refer or defer to DRBC water quality standards when it comes to the mainstem Delaware River. It doesn't mean we ignore the states by any means. We work with the states, collectively with the states, to set those standards, and I'm going to give an example on how we do that. From an anti-degradation standpoint, DRBC has got a large anti-degradation area called special protection water, similar to New Jersey C1 waters, where very strict anti-degradation standards for the mainstem Delaware River. Again, the C1 standard is a New Jersey standard for the tributaries and other parts of New Jersey. But for the mainstem Delaware River, we'll set a water quality standard and an anti-degradation standard for the mainstem itself. When you see that whole brown area there, or orange, whatever it's coming up on the screen, that's areas that drain to special protection waters. The special protection waters itself is the mainstem Delaware River. We also use docket approvals and administrative agreements to implement and enforce water quality criteria. Now, the great news for New Jersey is that New Jersey was first out of the gate with something we call one process, one permit, and I'm going to touch on that a little bit later. Effectively, we're going to work in the background with the state of New Jersey to administer our dockets or NPDES permits on a one process, one permit basis. So effectively looking at all the standards, but DRBC working in the background, so the regulated community only has one instrument to deal with. On the other side of the equation, from a water quality assessment standpoint, DRBC for the mainstem Delaware River, again, for the Clean Water Act responsibility that the states have to the EPA, will provide the data and the assessment for the entire mainstem Delaware River and provide that to the states. And they use that in their assessment reports to EPA. Now, if there's impaired waters, again, or that needs to be improvement, DRBC will lead the charge on impaired water recovery, will model improvement plans, will establish pollution budgets, will set interim and long-term goals, again, for the mainstem Delaware River. And then we'll work those into the dockets or the permits as appropriate. Now, I'm gonna go through a little case study here, and it takes a little bit of geography, so I'm gonna just get your bearings straight so that we're all on the same page. Here's the Delaware River estuary. We have assessment water quality zones, meaning we're going to look at the designated uses or the water quality assessment on a zonal basis. For example, zone one is non-tidal. Everything upstream of Trenton is zone one. We're not going to focus on that for today. Zone three is Philadelphia Camden, the most urban part of the estuary. Zone four is relatively urban as well. And zone six is the Delaware Bay. So that's just to get your bearings straight. River mile 100 is Benjamin Franklin Bridge. Head of tide is 133. River mile zero is Atlantic Ocean. Those may come up again just to get your bearings straight. I'm not going to go deep dive into this. If you need more information, there has been a tremendous amount of improvement in the Delaware estuary, from the pictures that you saw to improvement I'm going to talk about in a second. But if you want more information, here's a plug for our website. So let's just go over the aquatic life uses in the Delaware estuary right now. And the differences are a little nuanced, but we'll go through them. Again, the urbanized portion of the estuary is zones 3, 4, and 5. 3 is Philadelphia. The bay is 6. From an aquatic life use standpoint, you can see that upstream of the urbanized areas, both maintenance and propagation of aquatic life uses, and also a higher DO numeric criteria. Same on the other side. But in the urbanized area, it's maintenance only, and a lower dissolved oxygen criteria. Those were set in 1967, but they need to be looked at and they need to be updated. Now, I'm gonna focus you on a few things as you look at this. One, up top here, you see the dates moving, so focus on that. Two, what you see here is the water quality standards. Here's the Atlantic Ocean, river mile zero, head of tide. And what you're seeing here is that over time, dissolved oxygen has been improving, to the point where it's gone above the water quality standards that we set in 1967. That's a great story, right? Here's 2018, here's where it started, here's where we are now, it's gonna repeat itself. But you're seeing that at some point there was very little dissolved oxygen in the urban centers, and that's improved quite a bit over time. So that's the good news. If you look at a little bit deep dive, and this is a sort of a snapshot of what's going on right now, what you see is that we still have a bit of a dissolved oxygen, we still have a bit of a dissolved oxygen sag right here in the urbanized part of the estuary. And part of that is because while we addressed carbonaceous oxygen demand. We still have an issue with ammonia and ammonia nitrogen. That's coming primarily from Philadelphia, but not only. It also, there's other large wastewater systems that are also contributing. So again, without going too deep into it, just say that, look, we have an ammonia problem that we still need to address. The good news is that over time, you had this, you had this 30-mile dead zone in the river for a while, particularly bad in the summer, and I can't control this thing, I apologize. But over time, what you're seeing here is that even though we had near zero dissolved oxygen pre-Clean Water Act, you see this amazing improvement. Now those, I apologize. Those standards, again, were set in 1967, pre-Clean Water Act. And to this day, DRBC is still dealing with the issue of setting the standards and looking at the standards for the estuary. The other thing we looked at from a science perspective is, okay, if we just had a maintenance standard for aquatic life uses in the estuary, has that changed? And we found that there's some evidence for reproduction of certain species in the estuary, meaning it is time to potentially look at updating our water quality regulations. And that's what we're in the process of doing right now. Does the dissolved oxygen standard need to be upgraded because has the existing use gone over the current designated use in the estuary? And that's being done through a science-based approach and a collaborative approach. We're reviewing the dissolved oxygen requirements for key sensitive species in the estuary. We're enhancing the estuary monitoring. Sometimes that comes back to you, the discharges. We ask you to do the monitoring. Thank you, by the way. We're developing a very detailed hydrodynamic and water quality model. We're determining what the higher levels of dissolved oxygen would need to be to protect that designated use. We're developing new waste load allocations, particularly for things like ammonia, to achieve that new design criteria. And we're reviewing treatment costs. And we're looking at the attainability of those costs as well as part of the project. Ultimately, that could lead to new regulation for new dissolved oxygen criteria for the estuary. We don't do it alone. We take stakeholder input from our Water Quality Advisory Committee, and you can see some of the people that are on there. Environmental groups certainly are state and federal partners. And we also do it using scientific experts to help us with things like estuary modeling. Here's just a very quick snapshot of the model inputs that I think you'd all expect here. Again, it's a very point source oriented problem that we have, but we are looking at things like air deposition and runoff and CSOs and things like that. So we're not just modeling point sources, we're modeling the entire problem. That's just a brief view of the case study. The one thing I wanted to reinforce as well, and you can see those dots there, all those dots are in the Delaware River Basin, and I've tried to highlight New Jersey, is that we've got several different NPDES permittees. And in the past, there would be an NPDES permit and a DRBC docket. And again, we've changed that. We've decided, and with the cooperation and the leadership of New Jersey, we've tried to promote interagency cooperation, make sure that we're promoting interagency efficiencies and avoiding duplication. We recognize the authority of both, and I'm sure there's been presentations at this group talking about both. But I think it's been a win-win, both for the commission, for the regulator, probably a win-win-win, I think, for the agency, the commission, and the regulated community to get our act together and do it collaboratively, rather than, you know, doing it like this and hope they come together at the end. Let's do it from the beginning, and at the end, we'll ensure that it comes together. So we have a lot of things we do. I'm not going to go over all these things, but from a water resource perspective, we do a lot with a small group, from planning to operations through regulations, both on water withdrawal, wastewater discharges, our special protection water program, and we're doing a lot of science as well. And let me just touch on one issue that's probably an issue that's going to come up. We do a lot of assessment, not only of regulatory issues in the Delaware Estuary and the Delaware River, but we also look at emerging issues in the river. One such is PFAS. We've certainly been one of the early people looking for this, both in surface water and fish and in sediment. If you look at the fish sample back to 2004, just a brief snapshot of some of the things that we're finding. Certainly, I think you know that the health standard is 70. I know New Jersey's looking at lower standards, but it has some lower standards right now. Our drinking water intakes are at River Mile 110. So you can see that it's a little bit further down in the bay, but these are just some preliminary, not preliminary, they're samples of PFAS and PFOA. But certainly I just want to say that we're certainly looking at it and continue to look at our program and ways to monitor and then work with the states to help inform their regulatory programs as well. So the River Basin Commission is a unique agency. We're certainly built on the foundation that's defined in law, in the compact. We manage complex interstate water issues, collaborate with our partners and our members. We certainly have adapted a lot, and we'll continue to adapt as needed to meet the primary objectives of managing and protecting the river. We partner with our agencies to achieve together what they can't necessarily achieve on their own. Again, if you had just one agency on one side of the river trying to clean up their act and the other side didn't want to do it, the river is still going to suffer. So collectively, we do things together. And the results have been good, more than good. Shad Fest a week or so ago, the shad now migrate. There is no dissolved oxygen block in the river. You see this the major comeback for shad in the Delaware River. Even endangered species like Atlantic and short-nosed sturgeon are seeing a comeback. Fish advisories slowly are being eased on some issues in the river. And from an economic standpoint, you see the waterfront is a place that people want to come to again, and that's a wonderful thing as well. So it's not just about the fish, it's about all of us as well. It's about water resource for everybody. So we've been managing, improving, and protecting the resource since 1961. That's our mission, that's what we'll keep doing. I'll certainly answer any questions that you have. Thank you.